Good morning, welcome to Abundant Life Church on this 23rd of June 2024. Let us begin with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this new day, for this opportunity, Lord, to be together with one another and especially with you. And we pray your blessing, Lord, from heaven will flow down and touch each and every one of us. Thank you, Father. You are great, you are mighty. You are King of kings and Lord of lords, and thank you, Lord, that you are with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's turn to our scripture reading today, which is from Psalm 62. Psalm 62. This is a Psalm of David. It begins with, "Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. How long will you assault me? Would all of you throw me down, this leaning wall, this tottering fence? Surely they intend to topple me from my lofty place. They take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Yes, my soul, find rest in God. My hope comes from him. Truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depends on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. Surely the lowborn are but a breath, and the highborn are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or put vain hope in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them. One thing God has spoken, two things I have heard. Power belongs to you, God. With you, Lord, there is unfailing love, and you reward everyone according to what they have done." The Lord bless his word to us. Let us come before him and worship him.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised and adored. So we lift up holy hands in one accord. Blessed be the Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised and adored. So we lift up holy hands in one accord, singing, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, worthy, worthy.
continue to worship God with our gifts and offerings to Him. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness, your faithfulness to us, Lord. Thank you that you are always with your children. You never leave nor forsake them. So, Lord, as we give our offering to you, Lord, may you continue to watch over us and bless us, Lord, because we need you. We need your presence. We need your blessing upon our lives and this earth. Father, so we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This Wednesday we have our prayer meeting at 8:30. Do join us as we seek the Lord together for His presence to bless us and for our prayers to be answered. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Past few weeks we've been looking at the book of Hebrews, and we do so again today. So turn to Hebrews, and today we'll read from chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1. We must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. For if the message spoken by angels was binding, and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore such a great salvation? This salvation, which was first announced by the Lord, was confirmed to us by those who heard Him. God also testified to it by signs, wonders, and various miracles, and gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to His will. Father, we submit ourselves to you, and we ask for your Holy Spirit to work in our hearts and our lives, and especially our minds, Lord, this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Verse 1 says, we must pay more careful attention, therefore. And that therefore refers to the end of chapter 1, which refers to the name of Jesus. That is above all names, right? That's why we must pay careful attention, because He is the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. There is no greater authority, there is no greater power. There is no one else whom we should worship. There is no one else whom we should give attention to but God Almighty in Christ Jesus and His Holy Spirit. Right? Therefore, we must pay more careful attention. Right? We must not be distracted so that we drift away. So we must pay careful attention. Now, Jesus in John 14, 6 said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Right? He is the way, the truth, and the life. Right? He is life. He is the truth. And therefore, we must not drift away from Him, because if we drift away from Him, we drift away from the way to heaven. We drift away from eternal life. We drift away from the truth of God. Right? And if there's no truth, there are only lies. There are lies and deception. Right? And this world is full of lies and deception. Especially now with AI and deep fakes and so on. You may see and hear somebody you think you know and are familiar with. It could be your family member, but if it's generated by AI, it could be completely fake. You know, all these stories of begging for money, you know, they are stuck, they are in problems and so on. Or even, fantastic investment, you must come in right now. You mustn't delay. Otherwise, you will lose the opportunity. All kinds of deception lies and deep fakes. And that's why we must pay more careful attention to the truth that is in Jesus. Not the truth in this world. Because in this world, every so-called truth is relative, time limited, and every way temporary. The only permanent truth, the only permanent life, and the only permanent way to heaven is found in Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. So we must not drift away. What does that mean? That means there are things that will push us away, cause us to drift. You know, it's just like ocean currents. They will push you away. I remember once, you know, I rented a boat and I was paddling out. Then I wanted to come back to the shore. I couldn't. The currents kept on pushing me. Further down the shore, up the shore, depending on which way you were looking at it, I could not get back to where I wanted to go. I was drifting away no matter how much effort I put in. You know what I had? Finally, I decided rather than fight the current to get back to where I left, I would drift with the current. You know, so I followed the current. I paddled, and went nearer to the shore, but further down the shore, right? And when I got near to the shore, the currents were weak. So I then, very near the shore, I could paddle back to where I wanted to go. But there is this danger, that the currents of this world will push us, you know. The moment we open our eyes, open our ears, see the news and everything else, we are in danger of drifting. Those are the currents of this world that cause us to drift away from Jesus, from God. Why? Because they don't want us to be following God. They don't want us to get to heaven. They don't want us to have eternal life. That's Satan's purpose. He has come to kill, steal, and destroy. To kill us so that we miss out on God's eternal life. He wants to steal our joy, steal our peace. He wants to destroy us so that we will join him in hell. Right? If you don't go to heaven, there's only one other place, and that is hell. So we must be careful that we do not drift. We are not affected, carried away by the things of this world that are only temporary. Temporary. One day, everything, every deception, every lie will end. When our life ends, then everything in this world ends. So make sure that you do not drift away. Do not drift away from Jesus. From God, from the truth, the life, and the way to heaven. It says here, for if the message spoken by angels was binding, and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment. Right? Every message spoken by the angels, every word from God, every truth that God gives to us, God has said that every word that proceeds from his mouth will not return to him void, empty, without it having accomplished his divine, heavenly, eternal purpose. So every word of God is binding, has a purpose for eternity, and it will not return to him void until it has accomplished. And every word from God, every commandment, every instruction for God has a purpose. And if we do not listen to the purpose, we can get lost. Because that's the way God wants us to go, to get to heaven, not to get lost. The way of this world is for us to get lost. Satan wants us to get lost so that we miss out on heaven. And that's why God disciplines his children. You know, that's why in preparation for the communion, we read then as Corinthians 11, that God disciplines those he loves. God disciplines for a time so that we will not be condemned with the world. Discipline is meant to bring us back to the right path, bring us back to the truth of God, bring us back to the message spoken by angels, so that we do not fall into condemnation. Right? We will receive discipline, but discipline's purpose is to make us avoid complete failure. Right? The discipline of homework, the discipline of tests and exams, disciplines, because you have to work hard for your tests, exams, your assignments, you have to work hard for them. And they are disciplined because it means that you cannot go and do other things. You cannot be distracted by your friends playing, you know, going to the cinema, going shopping, playing games, doing all kinds of things. You cannot be distracted. So we must be focused on God, on his commands. So discipline. Every violation and disobedience receives its just punishment. Right? There is a cost. There is a punishment for every disobedience. But thank God, we have the blood of Jesus. We have the grace of God. We have the presence of the Holy Spirit to help us. That still small voice that tells us, you shouldn't be doing that, Lord. You should be careful, Lord. You should think twice before going any further. Right? That still small voice that reminds us, the peace of God passes all understanding. And we need to exercise faith and trust in God, believe in his word, obey his commands. Right? God will not shout at us and scream at us. Right? That is not God's way. But he will teach us, he will instruct us. Right? And if we violate, if we disobey, there is a price to be paid. Right? There is a price to be paid. And we may have to suffer some kind of discipline, some kind of punishment, so that we learn. The purpose of God is for us to learn, to improve. The ways of this world, the ways of world's religion, is not necessarily to improve, to learn. But God wants us to learn. He wants to guide us and lead us along the path of salvation. Right? That's why it says in verse 3, how shall we escape if we ignore such a great salvation? This salvation, the way of escape from death, that is what salvation is. Escape, the way of escape from death and condemnation. When you are condemned, you are sentenced to the eternal punishment. Right? So we escape through the salvation that is first announced by the Lord. What did Jesus announce? His first announcement, right, in Matthew 4 and 17. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. You know, after he was baptized, he went and preached, and his preaching was, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of heaven is near. Repent. That is the great salvation. Repent. Turn away from your ways. Turn away from the ways of this world. And if you turn away from them, you must turn to something. Right? You must turn to heaven. The kingdom of heaven is near. When you repent, you turn away from this world, you turn to the kingdom of heaven. Because it is near. Right? And it is time for us to look at the kingdom of heaven. Huh? We have been in this world. We have been living in this world. And we need to turn away from the temporary things of this world in order to turn to the permanent blessings of heaven that are found in God's great salvation, found in Jesus Christ. Then it says, was confirmed to us by those who heard him. Confirmed by those who heard him. So this is not far down the line, people who hear and hear and hear. But this is confirmed by those who heard him. His apostles confirmed. And that's why we have the Bible. We have the New Testament that tells us, that teaches us about Jesus. From those who heard Jesus' teaching. These are eyewitness, direct hearing teachings, not passed down through generations, and then finally recorded, you know, a few generations down the line, so that you cannot really trust. Well, yeah, you know, if a lot of people heard it and then it's passed down, then a lot of people can come together and confirm it. Yeah, and that was the case with the disciples. There was at least 12 of them, and then the 120, the other 118, who were in the upper room, right? Who had seen Jesus rise up to heaven, who heard the teachings of Jesus. Of course, the great crowds who followed Jesus, the great crowds who watched his miracles. Those heard him. Those heard him. And they saw the miracles. They saw the signs and the wonders. And Jesus even told the Pharisees, if you don't believe my word, look at the signs and the wonders, the miracles that are being performed in your midst. Right? If you don't believe me, believe in the miracles. Believe in God. Believe in heaven. Believe in the power of God and his great salvation. We are saved through faith. In Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. We are saved through faith. And this is the gift of God. Not by works, so that people can boast and say, oh, I saved myself. I believe. It was my belief, my faith. No. The faith we have is a gift from God. Right? It's a blessing from God that we have to receive and walk with. Right? It's a gift of God. What do you do with a gift? You receive it. And this salvation is a gift from God. You know, in this world, we can receive gifts. Right? And in our country, the best gifts, well, according to some, of course, I will never get such a gift, a datukship or some honor, a tansari or something like that from a sultan or from the agong. These kind of worldly honors. this is Malaysia. Malaysia bolehlah. Some people are reputed or rumored to buy these honors at datukship, right? And there's a kind of ranking of which state charges what. But of course, there are some states where you cannot buy. But some states are rumored that if you pay so much, you can buy a datukship. And it may be true that you can buy, because you know, there are some people who call themselves a datuk or who have a datukship, you know, and they put their datuk badge on their car, but they behave like scoundrels who do not deserve such an honor. Right? But God gives this gift of salvation, eternal life to all who believe. This is a free gift. And what do you do with a gift? You take it and use it. Just like every datuk, you know, they'll put a badge on their car because they are a datuk and there are certain privileges and honor. The police will be more relaxed towards you, you know, if for any reason they have to summon you. They will be maybe even turn a blind eye. That's why people put the datuk badge or even some other kind of badge, you know, on their license plate, near their license plate, so that the police see, this is somebody. So let them go lah. this is the way of the world. But we cannot escape God if we dismiss his salvation, because he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if we ignore, if we dismiss his gift of salvation, what do we have? We only have the punishment of sin, eternal destruction, eternal suffering away from God. You know? So, you know, if we accept the honors of this world and display it and make use of it, why not the great gift of salvation from God? Right? You know, if somebody gives you ₱1,000,000, wouldn't you accept it and say thank you? I would. Take it and use it. Right? No point somebody give you something and you store it away. Put it in a cupboard. Right? Put it in a cupboard. You know, the money doesn't last. Maybe you have ₱1,000,000 today. Somebody gives you ₱1,000,000. You know? But in a year's time, the ₱1,000,000may not be able to buy you much. You know, a ₱1,000,000 condo today, next year will be, you know, much higher price and so on. Right? So, what you get, what you have, what God gives to you, make use of it today. Don't keep it away. Don't hide it away. And the wonderful thing about God's great salvation, not only announced by Jesus, right, and confirmed by those who heard him, but even today, I mean, Jesus is not physically with us today. Yes, we have his word, the Bible. And those who heard him, the apostles and all the disciples, even the crowds of 4,000 who were fed, 5,000 men who were fed, all of them are no more. Long gone. Right? Long gone. But verse 4 says, God also testified it by signs, wonders, and various miracles, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. So we have the presence of his Holy Spirit to work signs, wonders, various miracles, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Right? In Mark 16, the end of the Gospel of Mark, Jesus said to them, go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, and whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands. And when they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people and they will get well. Right? These are the signs, wonders, and various miracles that God testifies. That God gives confirmation of his word that has gone forth. Because this accompanies, follows the preaching of God's word, God's good news to all mankind. God confirms. God doesn't abandon us. We are not left alone to our own. He is with us by his Holy Spirit, who lives within each one of his children. So we all have the potential to lay hands on the sick and they will get well, right? I don't advise picking up snakes and drinking poison lah. Unless the Lord really leads you, unless you are sure that the Lord leads you. But surely we can lay hands on people and pray for them to be healed, right? We can pray for people. And when they get healed, when they get well, that is a testimony to the reality of God. That confirms God's word, God's salvation to us. He is the living God who hears and who answers prayer. Answers prayer. That's why we come to Him. That's why we pray to Him. Because He answers prayer. He confirms His word that He is living, He is active. We are His children by healing, by answering prayer. Because He's living. You know, living person, you can call them, you can by name and they will answer. Yes, yes, it's me. What do you want? How can I help you? Right, there is a response. And because God is living, when we pray to Him, He hears and He answers. And it says here at the end of verse 4, gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to His will. Where are the gifts of the Spirit mentioned? In 1 Corinthians 12. Right? The gifts of knowledge, gifts of wisdom, right? Gift of faith, gift of healing, right? Miraculous miracles, prophecy, discernment, gift of tongues, and these are by the Spirit of God. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 8 to 11. If you want to follow it up, read it up. And verse 11 says, all these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and He gives them to each one, just as He determines. Gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to His will, as He determines. He decides, right? But it's by the same Spirit. And the same Spirit lives in every one of God's children. And He decides. And how does He decide? He will decide according to His will, His purpose. His purpose. So if we are in a situation where there is somebody sick and we pray for them, God will heal. Because God answers prayer. He will heal. So God testifies. And God confirms His word because He is living. Somebody who's no longer around cannot hear us, cannot answer us. But God is living, and His word is living and active. So I want to end with this, verse 1. So that we do not drift away. I believe that's the most important thing. We do not drift away from God's great salvation. From life with God, from His peace, His love, His joy. That keeps us, that protects us. Now, what is our life anchored on? When you talk about drifting, it refers to a ship. Sea currents and so on. Are we anchored on Jesus? Are we anchored on His words that are permanent, that are forever? Or are we anchored on the things of this world? What people teach us? What people instruct us? What our leaders tell us? What our Prime Minister or Agong tells us? Or even what I tell you? Are you anchored on people and their words? Or are you anchored on God? and His word. Whatever anyone says, you must be anchored on God and His word. Because everything in this world will pass away. Every desire, every greed, every lust, every thirst will pass away. But only what is for God will remain. So we must hunger and thirst for righteousness, thirst for God, not in anything of this world. We must be anchored on God, because He will not pass away. His word will not pass away. Father, we bow before You. We acknowledge, Lord, that we are human. We are influenced by the things of this world, by people who have all kinds of desires to make use of us. But we thank You, Lord, that You are with us. You have given us Your word. Help us to be anchored on You, on Your great salvation, on Your everlasting words, so that we will not miss the way to heaven. We will not miss the eternal life You have promised us. We will not miss the truth, the facts that are forever. Help us, God, to be anchored on You. Save us, Lord, from every deception and lie of this world. May they be destroyed in our lives, so that only Your word will remain, and the power and the strength of Your word will remain in each and every one of us. Father, we pray, Holy Spirit, for Your power to be upon each and every one of our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our spirits. Remove, Lord, every lie and deception of this world. And let only the word of Your great salvation, the truth of Jesus as the way to the Father, remain in us. Let everything of this world grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Thank You, Father. Do Your everlasting work in each one of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's rise as we close the service. Father, we thank You for being able to meet together, Lord. And we want to pray for You, Lord, to indeed work on Your word. We commit to You our sister Madam Chung and her nerve problem that affects her ability to stand up and walk. And we pray for healing for her in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, heal her, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We commit our brother Royce to You also, that You heal him, Lord, from every brain misfunction, malfunction. Strengthen his faith to believe and trust in You for complete healing in the name of Jesus. Thank You, God. Thank You, Jesus, that You have given us this great salvation. Thank You, Lord. Go with us. Bless our country this week, Lord. Let Your great salvation be upon our land. Bless even the Sungai Bakap by-election. As the candidates have been nominated, we pray for all the ceramahs and everything that will be going on, that everything will go on peacefully, that lies will not arise, deceptions will not arise, but truths, Lord, come out. We pray and commit to You our country. And even, Lord, when there is the election, let it be done peacefully, Lord. Thank You, Father. Bless us, bless our country. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you.